sing, 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 sing. Everybody start to sing. La-di-da, ho, ho, ho. Now you're singing with a swing.
Hello, welcome to our first of four specials this year of Italian Heritage and Culture Month. We are here, in fact, on the 1st of October, beginning of a long month of many activities, and we're here with Joseph Sciame, who is Cavaliere Ufficiale, who is Vice President at St. John's University for Public Relations, who is also the chair of the Italian Heritage and Culture Committee of New York, the poster you can see behind us, this year's poster, and we'll get to the theme of this year, and who is also chair of the Conference of Presidents of Major Italian-American Organizations. Well, welcome again to Italics. This has been an annual appointment for us here for our one-hour specials. You're the president of the Italian Heritage and Culture Committee, which is a New York organization. It's been around for 36 years now.
It's been around for 36 years, founded here in the city of New York when it was brought to our attention that there was no such week for our ethnic group. And as a result, Dr. Angelo Gimondo, who was then a teacher and became superintendent of schools in a Queens borough school, he and colleagues, mostly in education, founded our organization, and they thought it would be for 1 week. But of course, so many events were brought about over the years that then it was expanded to a full month. So indeed, October is our month, so to speak, mm-hmm. Italian-American month, where we bring out our Italianita. And it's very exciting because this year we are honoring the memory of Amerigo Vespucci. America is named for Amerigo Vespucci. Mm-hmm. And of course, he was someone who was not just here in North America, but South America as well. He was a navigator, he was an entrepreneur, a discoverer, a very important person. So we are honoring him this year on the anniversary, the 500th anniversary of his passing on in 1512. Many of us, even here in North America, have little understanding of the level, the number of Italians who traveled to South America by choice or by immigration. And many South Americans speak the language of Italy. So that is why the theme is what it is. And of course, the astrolabe, the piece in the center of the poster, which a lot of our young people are fooling around with their iPhones and technology, they can pick up information from our website. So we're very excited. I think for an organization that was founded in 1976, we're 36 years old, we've done a lot.
And I wanted to say, with regard to Vespucci, you had already organized an exhibit back in February of this year.
Yes, that mostra, the exhibit, as they would say, was brought to the Manhattan campus of St. John's University, sponsored by the Italian Heritage and Culture Month Committee. People saw it and thought, let's get this to Washington, D.C. And this exhibit will be unveiled on Thursday, October the 11th. We have a special bonus. We will have the unveiling of Greg Wyatt's design of what he sees as the spirit of Amerigo Vespucci.
Greg Wyatt is a very accomplished sculptor in his own right, and he's donating this.
Well, he's donating it, but what I think is more important about it is his work with young people.
Yes.
He is well known to go to Italy with Americans, Italian Americans, and others, and then tours them appropriately in the various artworks of Italy, especially in the realm of sculpturing. So I'm looking forward to this, and it's a wonderful donation, and it's a great tribute.
The other major sort of event or activity of the Italian Heritage and Culture Month is the awarding of the Leonardo da Vinci Award, which is an award that's existed now for, what, about 15, 16 years?
At least yeah. For a decade and a half. And for 2012, we have a wonderful awardee, and the awardee is Joseph Tuziani.
Poet, person to essayist, translator, fiction writer, yes. A person who introduced some major Italian poets through his translating, but a person who is a poet in his own right, a very accomplished international poet. In fact, not only does he write in four languages, English, Italian, his native dialect, and Latin. People don't know there's a small coterie of poets who around the world who write in Latin, and they write to each other in sonnets. Incredible. Also, besides writing their work in Latin. But Joseph is the first American ever to win the prestigious Greenwood Prize, poetry prize in England. So the fact that, you know, the so-called mother country of ours awarded this to an American and then to an Italian-American, an immigrant, is just fabulous. And there are other major accomplishments of his. He was invited to the White House back in the early 60s by President Kennedy to record for the Library of Congress. People could go and hear him reading his poetry for over an hour in the Library of Congress. And the other important thing is that he was also vice president of the Poetry Society of America at one point. All this in addition to many other awards and accolades that he's received over the years.
I'm very excited, and our board was very excited when his name was put into nomination. Mm-hmm. We only give out one award a year.
Very
What's exciting
nice.
About his being the awardee is here is this man who's with us today who has sailed his talents over the many, many decades,
but
his writings have been recognized such. So I think in many ways he is a discoverer, and we have so many discoverers in our Italian-American community.
Let me ask you a question about something that came up recently in the news, and it was in the newspapers, and it has to do with the Christopher Columbus statue.
Yes.
Because we've seen a lot of press about it, and there are those who feel that it's just a travesty. And then instead there are others who think it's wonderful that this structure has been built around the statue.
This opportunity at Columbus Circle affords the statue a restoration. And I do not see the money other than from this restoration group that will do it. The artist himself, he's done this in many other cities throughout the world. I was there recently at Columbus Circle, and I went around it several times late at night. Mm-hmm. And I see this structure being done, and I'm excited about it. I'm hoping I'm going to be one of the 50,000 people, I hope, that go up and see it. Yeah. I know the Columbus Day Parade Committee has not been negative about this at all.
No, not at all.
And they will continue to put their wreaths and proclamations and whatever are the honors we have for that weekend. Mm-hmm. But that is my opinion.
Yeah.
So our audience may agree, and if they don't, it's an interesting topic for us to discuss.
Yeah, because it's something that we've seen people react in ways that perhaps we expected differently.
Yes.
You know, and so in some cases, it was a pleasant surprise to see certain reactions.
I want to see personally more excitement about young people and opportunities for them for scholarship.
Exactly.
And scholarship in every way, studying, the graduation rates. I want to see graduation rates improve overall for all people, but our own Italian-American people, I want to see them onto the college, onto the graduate schools, and then obtain opportunities for scholarships.
And that's an interesting topic, and you know, we've spoken about this before, but let's throw it out, and then we can see what kind of reaction we get down the road. But 20, 30, 40 years ago, when many of the national organizations were giving out scholarships, they were basically given to students who were of Italian-American heritage. Perhaps back then, there was much more broad need, or the need was more broad among our population, whereas today, perhaps, it's not in some cases. And so while those scholarships were given to all these students, it seems that there had never really been a targeted discipline. And of course, what I'm thinking of is Italian studies or Italian-American studies, so that instead of giving five $1,000 scholarships to five students, one's going to do pre-med and one's going to do, I don't know, American history and what about a $5,000 scholarship to a student who is doing Italian studies or who's doing American history with Italian-American history, maybe as a concentration or something to that, you know? And I wonder if we don't need to reevaluate, rethink how we give out these scholarships.
I think we need to discuss that strongly in our community. and also do some research as to what organizations are really doing. Where are their funds going? How are they being focused? We have to work at it because we don't want to disregard merit. We can also combine merit with the study in Italian.
Right.
We know that at the high schools, many of the high schools are offering Italian. And when they do in local communities, they give out scholarships.
And in fact, in the same theme, this year we had our first relaunching, and hopefully it's the only one, relaunching of the advanced placement exam in Italian.
Yes.
And we had a good number of students who took the exam, well over 2,000, which is very close to a goal that we have to make 4 more years down the road. Mm-hmm. So that was very, and the scores were very good. Also, I understand the scores were very much in tune with the scores of the older exams, the French, German, and Spanish. So that was also good.
And it's important for a cost savings measure for those students.
Which is one of the reasons why we honored the foreign minister from Italy,
yes,
who was then the ambassador. He was without his intervention, without his support, without his campaigning, hardcore campaigning for the advanced placement exam, we might not have had it back up and running.
Well, we have to believe in the AP as a standard.
Yeah.
There's always commentary, you know, is it necessary? Some young people are already studying Italian. They're taking honors classes. Why take AP?
Right.
But it doesn't hurt. It doesn't hurt, and it looked great on a transcript for a student entering college. As a university administrator, I know this. So
exactly.
That's why I would be in favor of it.
Yeah, and in fact, with the AP courses in general, some students have entered college as sophomores.
Yes.
They've sort of done their whole freshman year. Good. Well, we have a number of events coming up. We have the poster. We have a booklet of another 150 pages like last year,
Wow. Chock
full of events that go through early December. And we're going to be out there almost every night at various and sundry events. Now, you're in charge of, before we close, you're involved in one of the borough president's events.
Yes,
at Queens.
For the borough of Queens, mm-hmm. The borough president has requested that we hold her proclamation ceremony at our university. So that will be on Tuesday, October the 30th. But in each of the boroughs, I think that's exciting. On September 30th, it'll be in Staten Island. The first week in October, we'll have it in the Bronx, in Brooklyn. And then we head to the Bronx. Manhattan is yet to be announced.
And in Manhattan, we have the borough president,
yes,
and we have the comptroller.
And the state comptroller.
And the state comptroller, so we have three
yes,
in Manhattan.
Yes.
Good. Well, it's going to be a busy month for us, but it should be fun again.
I think so.
Yes. Well, listen, I want to thank you for coming and taking time out of your busy day.
Great day.
Okay. In continuing our specials on Italian heritage and culture, we welcome Jim Perricone to Italics. And Jim Perricone is an environmental lawyer. He has his own firm. It's a specialization. He is, I should say, a lapsed literary scholar, however, who has not abandoned us totally. He does have a Master's of Arts in Comparative Literature from the University of Virginia, and he also holds his law degree, earned his law degree at New York University. Jim, welcome to our special.
Thank you, Dean.
Now, you're here because of your literary talents and not of your legal talents.
Right.
We want to talk about Strangers in a Strange Land, Italian Language Imprints in America, which is a special that opens September 19th, runs through November 2nd at the Grolier Club. What is it? It's from your private collection,
yes,
of books and imprints in Italian language,
correct,
produced in the United States.
Correct. That's a good summary. It's a collection that I've been working on for probably about 10 or 12 years, mm-hmm, in particular. I've collected Italian-American literature in English for a longer time, but there began to be scholarly work done in both Italy and the United States in the period about 10 to 20 years ago. And it fascinated me for several reasons. One was that it's hard to find these materials, mm-hmm, and I'm a collector. Collectors like to collect things, book collectors especially, that are hard to find, that you don't find many copies of. I was intrigued by the fact that there were few copies, and few copies in libraries, frankly, as well as copies to buy. But most of all, I was intrigued by the thought and the belief from the few materials that I had that I'd read in around the year 2000, when a collection came out in Italy called Italo-Americana Storia e Letteratura degli Italiani negli Stati Uniti, the year 2000, I was struck by the grittiness, the texture of the stories and the materials that I thought was largely absent in the English language materials written by Italians in the same era, early 20th century, typically early to mid, really ending World War II. And I was struck by it, and I thought maybe this holds a certain key to who Italian Americans are, that the English literature, the literature of Italian Americans in English, does not entirely. And the more I investigated it, and the more I read as well as collected, the more I saw a real picture of a whole culture of Italian American life lived in Italian. It may have been a majority of immigrants early on in the late 19th century, and then, of course, over time, it became a smaller number of Italians who, shall I say, clung to the language of their homeland. In some cases, interestingly, in many cases, Italians, Italian immigrants to this country learned more Italian when they came here because they largely knew, they came from an oral culture, and libraries in America were consistent with the sort of self-help culture that we Americans pride ourselves justly on. Libraries, public libraries, were wonderful at having Italian sections, both to help Italian immigrants learn English, but also to help them read in Italian and learn their native language.
And there were also
bookstores.
Not only bookstores, printers in Italian.
And I come from, the Grolier Club is a club of collectors and also dealers and librarians, rare book librarians. And I certainly come from a real passion and interest in the publishing aspect of it, because I wondered, who were these publishers? Did they publish one or two works and then disappear? Was it largely vanity publishing? And I found that there's very little scholarship in the area, which of course made it intriguing. The Immigration History Research Center in Minneapolis had the and has the business papers of the most important of those publishers, the Società Libraria Italiana, or the Italian Book Company. And I got copies of all of those materials and spent a fair amount of time going through them as a sort of exemplar of what the culture was about. But what I love about it is that the interrelations and interconnections among the writers and among the publishers, so that some of the most prominent of the writers, and I'll mention some of their names in a moment, didn't just publish through one of the publishers. They had ties and connections, often going back to their working on Italian language, Italian-American newspapers. The Il Progresso Italo-Americano, of course, was an absolutely key newspaper because its editors included at least half a dozen, maybe close to a dozen, of the writers who appear in my show, so either as editors or as contributors. The most important of the literary magazines was the Sisca family's La Folia di New York, which began very early in 1892 or 1893. And Ricardo Cordifero, who was himself a Sisca, but he used that pen name among others, and that was the most important one. He was one of the family members who directed the magazine, except when he was in jail because he'd get sued for libel. He was quite a character, a real ladies' man. But Cordifero published in La Folia, but he published elsewhere, and some of the other writers published in La Folia di New York as well. So there was a real cross-fertilization, one might almost say. And this extended to how they distributed the literature and how they became known as writers. In much more, frankly, much more interesting to me as a student of Italian-American history than what happened in English. I'll give you an example. Cordifero himself didn't just sort of stay in his room and scribble and publish. He went on various tours and lecture tours. For example, he had a standard lecture for about 15 years on Gabriele D'Annunzio. And he eventually published it in a book form, but it mentioned a half a dozen other places all around the country, from New York to Connecticut to Pennsylvania to California, I believe California in his case. Cote d'Ivoire was particularly interesting in that one of his important works, Ode alla Calabria, was actually published both in La Folia di New York and also in Buenos Aires, Argentina. And what's fun about it is that it's published for, obviously, for the large Italian population in Argentina, but it reflects a particular literary evening in Brooklyn, in New York, in about 1930 or 32, that took place where this poem was read by Cote d'Ivoire in Calabrian dialect. A translation of it had been made by Francesco Greco, who was an important Calabrian American poet. And the book is filled with literary reviews and letters praising Cote d'Ivoire, again, from all over the country. So we have from Houston, Texas, there was an Italian language newspaper, in Bridgeport, Connecticut, in Buffalo. And it's marvelous because what it said to me in reading these letters and reading about Cote d'Ivoire, lecturing all these places, is that there was a network and a culture. It wasn't just sort of individuals or a few, you know, writing for each other, a small scribbling crowd, but instead they reached a large audience, often through the Italian language newspapers. The fiction was published often in something called, it was often called Letteratura Pendice, and serial publication, much the way Charles Dickens, who was an early literary interest of mine when I was in graduate school and as an undergraduate in English literature, and so there was a following, there was a following. The most important of the writers, if you could pick one writer, Cote d'Ivoire was close to being the most important. The other one was, of course, Bernardino Ciambelli.
Ciambelli, right. And I wanted to ask you about Ciambelli, because he was really a prolific novelist.
He was a prolific novelist, but he was also an editor of Il Progresso for a while, of, is it La Voce del Popolo?
La Voce del Popolo.
And he was amazing. He was Balzacian in the way he'd have all-night bouts
of writing. In fact, you refer to him as either your Balzac or Zola.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, the Zola, maybe from a substantive point of view, of painting a picture of, you know, the gritty underworld of, in Ciambelli's
And case, Ciambelli did the series of the mysteries.
Right.
I Misteri di Mulberry Street.
Exactly.
I Misteri di Bleecker Street.
The Bleecker Street, right? Water Street.
Right.
I Sotterranei di New York.
Yeah.
And this itself followed a long-standing literary tradition, actually antedated Italian writing. The Germans, when they wrote in German in America, had a series of I Misteri, which is just marvelous to consider that there was an American tradition, but in foreign languages, and Ciambelli was actually walked in those footsteps in a way. But Ciambelli was enormously popular. I have, it's not in the show, but I have a copy of an advertisement from Il Progresso from 1898 that had no fewer than, I forget, four or five, maybe even six novels of Ciambelli that were available in book form at the same time. He just was enormously prolific. He published maybe
and popular and very popular.
Very popular. Yeah. Well, yeah, clearly he wouldn't. Yeah. His work wouldn't be in demand
Lost all of that, right? We lost all that. Now we can get a direct view, bird's eye view, direct view of this through your collection at the Grolier Club.
Right.
So you started this what, about 20 years ago?
I'd say I started collecting the material in English 25 years ago. But I only focused on the Italian language material in the last dozen years. Some of these things, Dean, there are no more than one or two copies in libraries around the world. The New York Public Library is a central source. But unfortunately, as has been that library's practice for a lot of materials because of space considerations, sometimes all they have is a microfiche or microfilm copy, and you don't have the physical text. And anybody who's a collector or a book historian, and I think of myself in part as a book historian, you have to have the physical text to really understand everything about the materials you're working with, because my interest is, how does this fit into Italian-American history? And therefore, I want to know about the generation of the actual literary work, but I also want to know about the book production, who the publishers were, and how did the economics of it work? What was the distribution like, as well as who was the readership? Because clearly that readership declined dramatically by the time of World War II and almost disappeared after that for reasons that are, you know, pretty well known to historians of Italian-American history, namely the suppression of political movements like anarchism and even some of the more radical socialists or syndicalists that culminated in the execution of Sacco and Vanzetti.
Right.
In the late 20s.
And that radicalism that existed.
Right. And, you know, it's an interesting phenomenon. It's of great fascination to me. One of the things I asked myself, I went to Columbia in the late 1960s when radicalism sort of had a revival. In fact, it was called the New Left, as you may remember.
Yeah.
And what it was interesting to me was that, was to know, I knew very little about Italian radicalism, but certainly, you know, there was a very clear difference between Italians and others, especially Jews, in how much those political ideals were passed along from generation to generation. The parents and grandparents of many of the radical students in the 60s were often leftists of various shades in the 20s and 30s, mm-hmm. but very few Italians, if any, among them, who were very active in, for example, Students for a Democratic Society. And so when I began to collect these materials and find out more, and you've been involved certainly in some of the scholarly conferences on what is often called the lost world of Italian-American radicalism, you sort of wonder why it didn't persist among the Italians. And there's a couple of basic reasons that I think most historians agree on. One is, again, the execution of Sacco and Vanzetti was a deeply depressing event to the Italian left in America. The fact that public school pedagogy discouraged the continuation of the use of not just Italian, of course, but other foreign languages, Polish. So this was my own, frankly, my own personal, you know, reclamation
too. What about this? What about the fact that I want to hold up one of these because this is Il Proletario, which is of course one of the radical newspapers,
right.
And I think this is 1923.
Right.
This one here, it's very interesting. I think that the radicalism was in Italian, mm-hmm. and I wonder if that had a lot to do with the fact that we lost that traditional, that sort of socio-traditional,
yes.
you know, sensitivity.
Right. Well, I think, yes. Well, first of all, just about Il Proletario is that it was a socialist, you know, not anarchist, not that you
right.
said
no,
it was,
not.
But it was, but, you know, the socialists and the anarchists often didn't get along.
Yeah.
But Il Proletario was a socialist newspaper. It was a wobbly newspaper, the mm-hmm. International Workers of the World. The American left took a little while before they realized that they would do better helping different foreign language ethnic groups have their own sections. So, for example, there was a Yiddish section of the IWW, an Italian section that followed, and I think also a Polish section, I'm pretty sure. Many of the works in my show were published by the Libreria dei Lavoratori Industriali del Mondo. The workers of the world.
Yeah, books. Yeah,
right. And so, and we started to talk before about the bookstores, and I think that's so fascinating because in addition to standard bookstores that would sell lots of things, you know, cookbooks and other things in Italian and traditional Italian literature from Italy, you had so-called red bookstores, Librerie Rosse. That was actually a term
called Librerie Rosse.
Right. That it sort of encompassed. Again, some of them were anarchist bookstores and anarchist publishers and socialist publishers, meaning this. You have take Carlo Fresco, who we haven't talked about, who's a terribly important figure, a fiery radical who sort of went the entire gamut from anarchism to anarchism, syndicalism to socialism. Fresco had his newspaper called Il Martello,
the hammer,
published out of his offices in Union Square, but he also had a Casa Editrice Il Martello that published in book form a number of important works in Italian. And some of them were, by the way, Italian translations. I mean, translations into Italian of English language work. So that within a year of the execution of Sacco and Vanzetti, Eugene Lyons, an American who wrote in English, published The Life and Death of Sacco and Vanzetti. Within a few months, it was published by the Casa Editrice Il Martello, Vita e Morte di Sacco e Vanzetti, Eugene Lyons, obviously a translation into Italian. And the same thing with Luigi Galliani, who, of course, was one of the two or three most important figures of the Italian left. He had a newspaper called Cronica Sovrasiva, but there was also sometimes it was called Casa Editrice Cronica Sovrasiva. That was, again, the publishing arm of the newspaper, the book publishing arm. So they often started as the radical newspapers and on a parallel track had their publishing arm, which is, you know, again, it's for me as a book collector, what I love about this is the transformation of the ephemeral in newspapers into the permanent or semi-permanent in book publishing. Although ironically, of course, it wasn't very permanent because the world of Italian language publishing really ended around World War II. So, but reconstructing that history has been a key, I think, for me, and I hope more in the future for other scholars, of the secrets of what Italian-American culture lived in Italian was really like.
And just so before we leave, so our audience knows, in addition, we said to the translation of Italo-Americana, which had shed some light on this.
Yes.
There is also a book that you're producing complimentary to this that has a number of essays in it and a number of reproductions of covers.
Right.
And that will be available by year's end.
Right. It's a catalog for the show, but it's more than that. It's really a permanent
record. I didn't want to call it a catalog.
No. Well, catalog sounds like it's sort of slight.
Yeah.
This is not slight. This is a extensive work, about 200 pages, with some scholarly essays, as you mentioned, by Francesco Durante and others, and a bibliography, and an extensive write-up of each of the 150 or so items in the show, because I want to tell a story that takes a little bit more time to tell than you can tell in a sort of a small label you put on an exhibition work.
Yeah.
So I try to tell the story as best as I can in three or four sentences for the show, but the catalog will really help tell the story, this cross-fertilization that I'm so fascinated
by,
especially.
So it's called Strangers in a Strange Land, Italian Language Imprints in America. It's at the Grolier Club.
47 East 60th Street.
Okay.
It's open to the public, free of charge, of course, Mondays through Saturdays from 10 a.m. to 5 p.m. And everybody's welcome to come see it. And often on Saturday mornings, I'll be giving little tours or lectures or chats about the exhibition, and none of them are closed off. They're all open to anybody who happens to be there at that time.
And so it runs through November 2nd.
November 2nd, that's the Friday.
We should also tell people that once the book slash catalog is ready, that we'll be having a presentation at the John D. Calandra Italian American Institute.
I'd be very honored.
Thank you for joining us today, and we'll see you soon.
Thank you, Dean.
Okay.
Thanks a lot.
We're here at the Calandra Institute with Ramu Damodaran, who is the director of the United Nations Academic Impact, a program that includes a few hundred colleges and universities around the world. And Ramu will speak to us in greater detail about that program. And he is also involved in a new organization or a project entitled United Academia, which we'll also get into. Welcome to Italics, Ramu.
Thank you so much, Anthony. Wonderful to be here.
So the United Nations Academic Impact, what is that?
It's, as you mentioned, a global alliance of about now 850 institutions of higher learning and education in about 120 countries. And the thread that links them all is a commitment to undertake at least one activity every year in support of a United Nations objective or mandate or cause, which pretty much means any global objective, because any global objective becomes a United Nations idea.
Right, and there are 10 principles. Mm-hmm. Now, I'm not going to ask you to recite all 10 principles, but there are 10 principles, and we, in fact, of the Calander Institute, became involved this past spring when we were involved, in fact, in the project that was entitled, as I called it, United Academia, which is the brainchild of Maestro Luciano La Monarca of the Puglia Center of America.
Yes.
And we were in Puglia, in fact, together on this project. Why don't you tell us a little bit what that was about?
I think it's a tremendous innovation that Luciano brought to bear, because what he has done is to create an alliance of partnership, if you will, between a cluster of universities in Italy, in the Puglia region, and a cluster of universities here in New York, including the Calandra, where I'm privileged to be at the moment. And this opens up all kinds of possibilities, because there's already a commonality of intellectual or scholarship exchange. But then to focus that on a UN objective is something which I think Luciano instinctively felt, because of his own role in working with us. United Academia actually, in a sense, began on the first anniversary of the United Nations Academic Impact in November 2011.
So the program, the United Nations Academic Impact, goes back to 2010.
10 November.
So it's a fairly young program.
Yeah, it's just about 18 months old. Mm-hmm. And on our first anniversary, Luciano arranged this concert at Purchase College, just outside New York City, which was under the auspices of the then nascent United Academia. Mm-hmm. And now it's grown. We have the University of Salento, the Aldemoro University in Bari, the Bari Polytechnic, all joining on the Italian side. Mm-hmm. We have the Calandra Institute and Hofstra University, and of course Fordham University on the United States side. And my hope and expectation is that this will lead to a similar range of models, because it builds upon not only the community exchanges, and the United States is a country where virtually every international community is represented one form or another, but also bring that indigenous scholarship from those countries. For instance, as you remember, when we launched United Academia, we had a wonderful seminar on the Mediterranean diet, which was mercifully more short on talk and long on food, but still, but that's how it should be. So, and I think that was a tremendous way to show the unexpected nature of academic interchange.
And in fact, we should say, though, that there was, in fact, the academic underpinning, because it was at the Culinary Institute in Bari.
Yes.
So we were definitely in theme. We remained in theme. And that was great. In fact, that was great. You said there are 800 universities around the world.
Right.
And how many countries?
I would say, as of now, about 120 countries.
Yeah.
And a lot of them are single university representation. Mm-hmm. But the idea is that when a university takes a conscious decision to join this, what it's doing is, it's a very interesting thing, Anthony. It's acknowledging that the United Nations is not political. Because the one thing I think universities around the world are extremely and rightfully jealous of is their non-political character.
Yeah.
And I would have said about 20 or 25 years ago, universities would have been a little diffident, because the United Nations was such a political animal in the sense of the tensions between the superpowers, the issues with which it could deal. But now it's become a people's organization. We deal with issues like hunger, poverty, women's rights, girls' education. And these are issues which affect every one of the 7 billion people that the planet holds. And so when a university says it's going to work with the United Nations, it's working for those 7 billion, not for what was once a political organization.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So it's only 2 years old. You have over 800 institutions.
Right.
Some are institutes such as the Calandra Institute.
Right.
And you celebrated. When's the next anniversary?
Well, our anniversary is on November the 18th, and which is a very busy time at the United Nations, because all our political and legislative committees are in session. So it's always difficult to organize something then. But I know that a number of well-wishers, including the Puglia Center of America and others, are planning events around that date, including art exhibits in the greater New York area. We have a conference which is coming up in Linz in Upper Austria, organized by the International Association of University Presidents to commemorate the second anniversary. So, great. You know, we are not ourselves going to be leading or directing the effort, but it's wonderful to see that
the various members,
exactly this punctuation mark which people observe,
because it means that their name is not just on a list,
right,
but in fact that they're doing something,
right.
I think it's a wonderful idea. Of course, you know, we decided when I read the 10 principles, ours, we picked number 10 because it deals with intercultural communications, relations, etc., and of course what we do here at the Calandra Institute, studying the history and of the Italians in America. What were some of the challenges of getting this up and running? Because you had to write to everybody, first and foremost.
Yeah, there were a number of logistical challenges, but I think what worked us well was that we had a number of umbrella organizations which were quite enthused, including the American Council on Education, the International Association of University Presidents, the Association of Indian Universities, the Association of Arab Universities, and they circulated this to their membership. But we did a lot of cold calling. You know, we suddenly saw someone's article in a newspaper, a professor somewhere, on an issue with which the United Nations deals. And through that introduction, we got the university to sign on. But I think, Anthony, the real challenge is that I think when you're in a university, you're essentially extremely young. Mm-hmm. In spirit, whether you're a student when you're chronologically young,
right,
or you're a teacher when, because you're dealing with young people, you yourself are at least mentally young, and you feel you've got all the time in the world before you, and you do not realize that you may have a finite time in which to make a mark on this world. And I think, frankly, John Calandra is a perfect example. I mean, look at this man who had no idea that he was going to die before he was 58 years old, but look at all that he did, because he invested himself in his community, in the politics of the state, in a greater honor that that brought. And if you transpose that same spirit to universities, that is where our challenge lies. You go to universities and say, you have only so much time in which to make a difference. And that difference is not a difference that you make for yourself alone. Go for individual excellence. Go for putting your mark in terms of your scores and your degrees and your academic distinctions, but take it just that one step further where it makes a difference to the world.
Right.
That is the challenge we have.
Well, but even if one does concentrate on the individual grades, marks, etc., they do have ripple effects.
Absolutely.
They have ripple effects.
But people must realize that.
Yeah.
You know, I think what happens is the people who see these marks and grades realize it makes a difference, but either because of modesty or because of a simple feeling of inadequacy, people, it takes a great leap of imagination to realize that what you're doing, which is excellent, can have global significance. Yeah.
You know, this brings me to the part of a conversation that's going on today about higher education.
Right.
And how perhaps universities have become a little bit too enclosed in their enclaves. And I think that while we can discuss ad nauseum the benefits or lack thereof of something like online education, for example, I think online education has really had a positive effect in the sense that you can reach more people.
Right.
They don't have to be there physically. And so there's a challenge right there that's overcome, let's say, or that's met. So, I like the idea that it does. It's analogous to what we talk of in the University of Town Gown, you know, the local college. I'm thinking of the local New England college that is in a little town, and there's a big separation between those two communities, that is the college and the town, right? I taught in two of those local colleges in New England, and it was great, but there was nonetheless that tension there. The idea of, and one of our colleagues, Fred Gardefe, who's our distinguished professor of English and Italian American Studies, says we need to bring the academy to the streets. We need to make sure that the people outside of the academy understand what we're talking about, and so that while we're in our academy, in our little world, we can use certain language, certain words, certain registers, etc. When we go out, we have to do it a little bit differently. We have to make sure that our language changes and things of that sort. And that's what one of the things that excited me about this idea of United Nations Academic Impact. Just the very name of it means that the Academy is going to impact something, and clearly not itself, but something outside.
Well, in a sense, what we're doing is probably building upon that and taking the streets into academia.
Right, exactly. You know,
because that's what the United Nations is all about. It's main streets around the world. It's the people who populate them, who work there, who live there, who love there. And their concerns, their passions, their needs, their desires. Mm-hmm. And some of these, frankly, are realizable. Mm-hmm. Some of them may be at a philosophical or metaphysical plane, and we probably won't venture there. But then things which are practical and achievable, why not? And this is I think the entire logic that we bring. And you really, Anthony, by focusing on what is probably the most broad of our 10 principles, the one on unlearning of intolerance, mm-hmm. have really hit it, because everything begins with that one principle.
Yeah. You know, I want to just ask you something about that. Just get your own, if you can, because you're in a certain position. But I'm always bemused by the use of the word tolerance instead of acceptance. Mm-hmm. And I don't know if you've thought about that, but we a lot of organizations that are, to use the old term, anti-defamation mm-hmm. organizations, they seem to be using the word tolerance or intolerance. And I like the word acceptance better than tolerance, and perhaps because I'm a child of the 60s, and everything was acceptance, whatever. So. But I don't mind I don't have any issues with the word intolerance, because that is the problem, mm-hmm. and we have to unlearn that. But from intolerance, I would go to acceptance.
It's a fair point. Yeah. I would only argue that in that field, things have really worsened.
Yeah.
So you need to be tolerant before you learn to accept.
Yeah.
And now we're in a state in many parts of the world, within countries, within communities, among communities, where people, far from learning to accept, have not even learned to tolerate.
Yeah.
So you have an automatic, and it's for a number of reasons, including, frankly, innate reasons of prejudice or a sense of alienation from people who are not like you, to very practical economic considerations. Mm-hmm. A person who is from another ethnicity or another part of the world threatening your livelihood or your job, and we have to factor all this in. So it's a very sad regression to my mind, which mm-hmm. makes it necessary initially to tell people, look, let's begin to at least tolerate each other as fellow citizens on this planet. Then comes the question of acceptance, because acceptance implies a welcome, an mm-hmm. assimilation. Mm-hmm. It's something much more positive. But mm-hmm. would that we could go back to the time where, as you said, we took tolerance for granted and had to work for acceptance.
Yeah. That's a good point. With the United Nations Academic Impact, what's the ratio between, and I don't know what monikers we should use, Western, non-Western, European, non-European, whether we want to do continental, whether we want to do directional, whatever. What's the ratio of institutions among these 800? What's the distribution?
I would say roughly, if you talk about what, again, for want of a better phrase, say the developed world and the developing world, I would say we have about two-thirds of this 800 plus in the developing world and about one-third in the developed world. And,
that's interesting.
And most of that one-third is from universities in the United States, where we have about 160 or so. Mm. We are very low in representation in Europe. Mm. Italy is, we have 22 universities from Italy, which is a sizable number.
Okay.
But we don't have very many in Germany, France, Scandinavia, Spain, Portugal, and so on. So that is certainly a lacuna that would bring this up. We have about 8 universities in Japan. We have about 30 in the Republic of Korea. So I would probably consider those more on the developed side. So that's the aggregate which I'm coming to. But we have about 60 universities in India, for instance.
Oh, okay.
And we have about 40 or so in China, which, again, I'd be putting in the developing category, mm-hmm. apart from universities in virtually every country in Africa. I would say about 5 or 6 of the countries in the Middle East or the Arab region, and about, all told, about 25 or 30 in Mexico and South America.
So two-thirds from what you call developing countries, mm-hmm. and one-third from developed countries. And, right. and Europe is sort of scarce, huh?
Europe is, and I have a feeling it's also because, and you would probably know far better than I do, Anthony, because of being an educationist, mm-hmm. but European universities have so many more umbrella organizations to which they belong. It's it's very much the academic interchange, both because of the community, the EU and the EU.
Right, the EU, you know, yes. with the whole, what right. they have that Erasmus program.
Exactly,
where
yeah, and the Bologna
students,
process.
Right, the Bologna
so
process, exactly.
So all of that, so maybe they just don't want to add yet another alliance. That's possible.
Yeah, that's very possible. Great. So we have to figure out what we're going to do with United Academia, I guess. Well, we, of course, as we were speaking before we began this conversation, we at the Kalander Institute will recognize a number of our programs as
UNAI,
UNAI, and our first, in fact, is a presentation of a book that deals with immigration into Italy. And 15 story. It's a small book written by two young journalists.
Oh, the Lampedusa.
The Lampedusa.
Oh, that's
exactly.
Wonderful.
Yes. Yeah, 15 stories of right. Told by the people coming on those boats, the trials and tribulations of leaving their home countries and crossing the Mediterranean and
right.
and what all that's about. It's not a happy scene, of course, in Italy. We know well all of the Mediterranean with the migration that's going on is not a happy. Happy scene. Then I think that's something that perhaps we can talk with our friend Luciano and see if maybe in the next year or so we do some sort of symposium on migration.
Absolutely.
And what it means, how Italy figures
yes.
as a point of migration. Because Italy, they don't just stop in Italy. Lampedusa is actually a springboard, not just in Italy, but into the rest of Europe,
right.
and sometimes the French and the German get mad at Italy because they're saying that they're letting them through into the European
yes.
Union. So, well, great. I'm glad you were able to take some time and stop by. We will be definitely crossing paths, and we'll be working more in the future.
Thank you so much, Anthony. Thank you for welcoming me here. Thank you.
Everybody start to sing, la-di-da, ho, ho, ho. Now you're singing with a swing. Singing with a swing. Do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do
Day.